a day of new beginnings, time to remember and move on, time to believe what love is bringing, laying to rest the pain that's gone. For by the life and death of Jesus, God's mighty Spirit now as then can make for us a world of difference as faith and hope are born again. Then let us with the Spirit's daring step from the past and leave behind our disappointment, guilt and grieving, seeking new paths and sure to find. In faith we gather round the table to taste and share what love can do. This is a day of new beginnings. Our God is making all things new.
Rhonda the Rabbit, or Why We Should Love Our Enemies, by Carol McDonald. Rhonda the Rabbit has a special friend named Susie. Susie was given a bunch of carrots and she decided to share them with her friend Rhonda. So she hopped over to Rhonda's hutch and left a large carrot by the front door since Rhonda was not home. Susie was so happy she was able to share with her friend. The next day, when Susie and Rhonda were coloring eggs for fun, and Susie asked Rhonda if she enjoyed her carrots. "What carrot?" asked Rhonda. "Why, the carrot I left on your doorstep yesterday, of course," Susie answered. Rhonda looked so confused. So Susie said, "Farmer Brown gave me a bunch of carrots, and I wanted to share with you. So I left you a carrot by the front door since you were not home because you are my friend." Rhonda told Susie that there was no carrot by her front door when she got home. Rhonda was sad and pretty mad. Who would take her carrot? Why would they take something that was not theirs? "Just wait till I find out who took my carrot. I'll let them know just how mad I am." Rhonda spent the day asking everyone she saw who took her carrot. That carrot was really special to Rhonda because her friend gave it to her. She was about to give up when she saw Billy Bunny hopping in front of her hutch with his friends. "Billy Bunny, did you see someone at my front door yesterday eating a carrot?" Rhonda asked.
"Well," Billy stammered, "my friends and I came by your house yesterday and saw a yummy-looking carrot, so we ate it, but we didn't know it was yours. It was just lying there."
About that time, Susie hopped up to the group. "Rhonda," said, "Susie, did you hear what Billy just said? They ate my carrot. I am so angry." Susie was angry too. "You are not our friends anymore. You stole Rhonda's carrot and that makes you our enemy," shouted Susie. Rhonda and Susie hopped into Rhonda's hutch and slammed the door. Billy and his friends hopped off to Billy's hutch. "Man, they're really mad at us," Billy said to his friends. "They called us their enemy." Billy's friends didn't know what to say. They felt bad for eating the carrot that was so special to Rhonda, but Billy just got angry. "If they want to be my enemy, then I will be their enemy," said Billy. I will throw Easter eggs at their house. I will not play with them anymore. I will tell other people how mean they are," Billy shouted. Billy's friends felt awkward. They wanted to help Billy, but they knew that throwing eggs and gossiping about Rhonda and Susie was not right. The next day was Sunday. Rhonda and Susie loved Sundays. They go to Sunday school to learn about Jesus with all of their friends. This particular Sunday, Miss Juniper, the Sunday school teacher, talked to them about loving their enemies. She said that Jesus wanted them to love people who did unkind things. After church, Susie said, "Rhonda, what did you think about what Miss Juniper said? Do you think we should be kind to Billy Bunny and his friends?" Rhonda had been thinking the same thing. If Jesus can love us, even though we do unkind things sometimes, we should be like him and love Billy Bunny, even though he stole my carrot, Rhonda told Susie. All the way home, they discussed how they could be kind to Billy Bunny and his friends, and they came up with a plan. They rushed off to talk to Farmer Brown. "Of course you can have a bunch of carrots, Susie. I like that you are going to love your enemy, and I'm very proud of you," said Farmer Brown with a smile. Rhonda and Susie thanked Farmer Brown and took the bunch of carrots to Billy Bunny's hutch. Rhonda was nervous. She knew that Billy was still angry. He wouldn't even look at her in Sunday school. She hoped that Billy would be her friend again. Susie knocked on the door. Billy opened the door and was surprised that Susie and Rhonda were standing there with a bunch of really yummy-looking carrots. "What are you doing here? I thought we were enemies," Billy asked Rhonda. Susie smiled and handed the carrots to Billy. Rhonda said, "We were thinking about our Sunday school lesson, Billy, and we decided that we should be kind to you just like Jesus told us to. Besides, you're our friend and we miss playing with you," Susie added. Billy exclaimed, "I miss playing with you too. Rhonda, I'm really sorry I ate your carrot. I know it was special to you and I should not have taken it without permission. Can you forgive me?" Rhonda smiled and said, "Only if you forgive me for being mean and calling you my enemy." The three friends ran off to find Billy Bunny's friends and share the bunch of carrots with them. As they passed Farmer Brown, he smiled and waved. He knew that Penelope and Susie and Billy had all turned the other cheek and loved their enemy. Farmer Brown was glad that the friends had forgiven one another. And the moral of the story, my friends, is that we should love our friends and our enemies, even when it's difficult, just like the Bible says. The end.
Love is sincere. Let your love keep you joyful.
Oh, Lord, there is so much before us. It is truly beyond us. And so we are driven to our knees, considering that you are far beyond us and there's nothing beyond your scope, your power. We pray, oh God, that the prayer of Saint Francis might attend our hearts as we look out. May we pray that you would make us instruments of your peace, and together a grand instrument of your peace. We see hatred, and where there is hatred, let us sow love. We see injury in our world, and where there is injury, God, let us give pardon. We see doubt, and where there is doubt, God, let us respond with faith. Where we see despair, bring us hope, make us vessels of hope. We see darkness, O God. May it be replaced with light, and may we shine as the light of the world, as Christ has called us to do. We see sadness. Where sadness exists, may it be replaced with joy, joy founded in you, and may we be a people of joy. O Divine Master, we pray that you will grant that we might not seek so much to be consoled as we seek to console, that we might seek not so much to be understood as to understand. O Divine Master, grant that we might not seek so much to be loved as we seek to love. For God, we reflect with Saint Francis, it is in giving that we receive. It is in pardoning that we are pardoned. And it's in dying that we are born to eternal life. So, O God, let us together pray in the name of the one who died and rose again and taught us to pray in this regard, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
With a vision in our minds of how the world could be, and the fullness of our hearts from the suffering we see, when we make all that we are and have part of God's destiny, we can fill this world with love.
All the people in this world living lives of pain and fear, crying out into the night, wondering when someone will hear, while there are so many others having so much they can share. Can we fill the world with love?
We whose spirits long to share, long to comfort and to heal, know that when we act alone, hope is difficult to feel. But together as we labor, God's compassion to reveal, we will fill the world with love.
Let us hesitate no longer in our doubt and our dismay. There's a power at work within us that has promised a new day. And the time will surely come, it will not be long delayed, when God fills this world with love. When God fills this world with love.
Romans 12, 9 through 21. Let love be genuine. hate what is evil, hold fast to what is good. Love one another with mutual affection. Outdo one another in showing honor. Do not lag in zeal. Be ardent in spirit. Serve the Lord. Rejoice in hope. Be patient in suffering. Persevere in prayer. Contribute to the needs of the saints. Extend hospitality to strangers. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse them. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Weep with those who weep. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be haughty, but associate with the lowly. Do not claim to be wiser than you are. Do not repay anyone evil for evil, but take thought for what is noble in the sight of all. If it is possible, so far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all. Beloved, never avenge yourselves, but leave room for the wrath of God. For it is written, "Vengeance is mine, I will repay," says the Lord. No, if your enemies are hungry, feed them. If they are thirsty, give them something to drink. For by doing this, you will heap burning coals on their heads. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. The word of the Lord for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
A few weeks ago, President Trump gave a speech celebrating America's national parks. And in that speech, he mispronounced the name of Yosemite. Struggling a couple of times. One of the times it was Yosemite and Yosemite. And I chuckled along with everybody else, I have to admit. You know, but to be honest, I've been there. I mean, I know what it feels like. I've mispronounced people's names in funerals. You know, one time and only one time, I totally said the wrong name of the deceased. Ooh, yikes. In past sermons, I have mangled the names of athletes, the names of celebrities, the names of cities around the world, not to mention the names of people and places in the Bible. You see, I could empathize with the president. It doesn't mean that I agree with him all the time, but it does help to remember that he's human and I'm human, so there's some sort of bond that is formed which connects us even when we have differences. In our text today that we just heard Raylene read, it could be considered as a call for extreme empathy. A pandemic of kindness, if you will. When Paul wrote the letter to the church in Rome, he spent the first 11 chapters outlining the foundational Christian truth, how God is for us, loves us unconditionally, and is working to restore the whole of creation according to divine providence. Now, beginning in chapter 12, Paul shifts to our response to this good news. How are we supposed to act now that we know God's love? And how are we supposed to act if we are truly a part of the beloved community? How do we embody in daily actions the commandment to love one another as God has loved us? Sometimes the Bible testifies to the grandeur and magnificence of God with soaring language of visionary scope, punctuated with hallelujahs. This isn't one of those. Here we find plain vanilla words of utter clarity to guide our daily path. Love sincerely, show honor, don't be haughty, live peaceably with all, contribute to the needs of others, persevere in prayer. Doesn't take a preacher to interpret this. It's a description of people at their finest, acting with compassion, acting with faith and generosity towards one another. We get it. And mostly we aspire to being that kind of person. And I'm being I'm betting every one of us can bring to mind a person who fits that description. And I can't actually see into your living rooms, but I see in my mind a bunch of the people in the homes right now, sitting there. I wonder if the truest test of faith lies not in the big watershed decisions of our lives, but in the everyday, reflected in the ways that we treat others. Certainly, the pandemic has brought out the best in us. I've heard of young people insisting on grocery shopping for elderly neighbors. Someone going and buying pizza for the entire emergency room personnel at a hospital. Overall, I think that food pantries, the gifts to food pantries are significantly higher right now. Musicians and artists, even the famous ones, can't go to their usual venues and have all these crowds, so they're giving their craft away for free on the internet. However, at the same time, fears of uncertainty and frustration and the restrictions and the vision of a future that we can't predict has exasperated long-standing resentments. It's caused people to retreat into a bubble. In a difficult time that leaves no one untouched, it's disheartening that as a nation, we have not come together. But we remain deeply divided, angry and unkind to one another. If we are disciples first, followers in the way of Jesus, we are called to a higher standard than simply tolerating others or just being nice to people with whom we differ. God calls us instead to an active, positive behavior, actually to bless those with whom we disagree. We need to hear the second part of this text today, even more than the first part. All that stuff about blessing other people, the ones who have hurt us, who have wronged us, the ones who we consider enemies and would choose to avoid completely, seems to be the important word for this time, and the one we keep mispronouncing. Especially during this political unrest, the call to civility has to be a start. God calls us to a basic courtesy and respect. Here's the thing, friends. Christ followers are called to a higher standard than simply tolerating or being nice to people that we disagree with. God calls us instead to an active, positive behavior, actually to bless them. The Apostle Paul was echoing the teachings of Jesus about loving one's enemies and going the second mile to care and support them. It's one of the distinctive contributions of Christianity to act for the well-being of one's enemies, to seek their good. Impossible? Yeah, pretty much. Let's be honest. You know, I used to be cheered in this impossible task, at least by the verse about heaping coals on our enemies' heads. If we had to show kindness to our opponent, at least we could take pride in our moral superiority, right? Take that blessing, you hateful idiot, and feel embarrassed about it. Well, no, I can't even use that one anymore. You know, when you study, you find out things. I had to find this bit of info this week to clarify the meaning of this reference. Come to find out, it has nothing to do with shaming one's opponents, as much as we'd like for it to be that way. Evidently, in ancient Israel, the center of the home was a small fire in a brick or hard clay structure, providing warmth and heating for cooking. And the fire went on all day and all night, every day. And if it burned out, you had a crisis. If it burned out, you would have to take a bowl and balance it on your head and go in search of a neighbor to receive live embers to reignite it. A kind wood would heap coals into your bowl. And guess where the bowl was? So this was one more way to bless one's enemies, to share your fire with them, heap fire into the bowl on their head. Let that sink in for a minute. It's the spark that can save the world. Spark that can save us. If we share our fire, then we find the embers of our own burned out souls reignited. It's not a zero-sum game. There's enough fire for everyone. And when we can remember receiving, then it's easier to give. Last year, Jewel Box Theater, under the direction of the amazing Al Bostic, presented the play A Raisin in the Sun. In the play, an African-American family inherits $10,000 from their father's life insurance policy. The mother of the household sees in this legacy the chance to escape the ghetto life of Harlem and move into a nice home in the countryside. And the brilliant daughter, what she sees in the money is a chance to go to medical school. But the older brother, he has a plea that was difficult to ignore. He wants the money so that he and his friend can go into business. He promises that they can just have enough money and take this money, he will be able to make so much more money that everybody gets to fulfill their dreams. And against her better judgment, the mother gives in and gives the money to her son. This so-called friend skips town with the money, and the son has to go home with the bad news. And his sister, she lashes out at him with a barrage of ugly words. Her contempt and hatred for her brother has no limits. And when she finally takes a breath in the midst of her tirade, the mother interrupts her and says, "I thought I taught you to love him." And the daughter answers, "Love him? There's nothing left to love." Then with powerful and moving words, the mother responds, "I can still hear how powerfully Norma Goth said these words in the Jewel Box production. She said, there's always something left to love. Have you cried for him today? I don't mean for yourself and your family because we lost all that money. I mean for him, for what he's been through, and for what it's done to him. When do you think is the time to love somebody the most? When they have done good and made things easy for everybody? It's when he's at his lowest and can't believe in himself because the world has whipped him. When you start measuring someone, make sure you take into account what hills and valleys he's been through." It's downright ironic to think of a pandemic of kindness healing the world. It's counterintuitive and requires vulnerability and imagination and spiritual strength. But this is the way we get better. Empathy helps us break out of the time-worn ways of relating to each other based on passive-aggressive behavior and one-upsmanship. Krista Tippett is a journalist, a best-selling author, and the host of an NPR and a podcast called On Being. She considers spirituality and faith as seriously as politics and science, and has interviewed hundreds of people to mine their truths. She suggests that kindness is powered by curiosity, a willingness to be surprised, to let go of assumptions and allow ambiguity in order to see the humanity of the other. There's a movie out there called Pay It Forward. There's this boy, Trevor, he's an 11-year-old, and he's been given a school assignment to think of an idea to change our world and then to put it in action. His idea, pay it forward instead of paying it back. You help someone, then they help someone, and in theory it goes on and on and on. As he leaves school, riding his bike home the day he got that assignment, he encounters a homeless man.
My friend's coming in to take a shower, okay?
Okay.
What is that supposed to mean?
What do you think it means?
Why don't you tell me what it means?
You're sneaking it.
Not sneaking anything.
Okay.
Trevor.
Trevor, wait.
No, I don't want to lie to you. I want to talk to you. I want you to sit down for 1 minute. Hey,
it's Jerry.
You get out. Okay. Get out of my house.
Thanks
a
lot.
What? Get out. Okay, let a strange man into my bathroom.
He's my friend.
What? You can't have a friend like that.
For my assignment.
What assignment?
You won't get it. Mr. Simonette will get it.
Who's Mr. Simonette? Hey, I'm talking
He's
to you.
He's my teacher.
What did you tell my son to make him bring a homeless man into my house?
It's an assignment I give out at the beginning of every year to inspire. I don't expect them to actually change the world.
This is my kid. You don't know him. You tell him he can do something, he's going to believe you. And when he can't, it's going to wipe him out. Jesus. You are really something.
Thanks. I appreciate the euphemism. I've always wanted to be something.
I swear to
Please
God.
Don't shoot. Please.
What are you doing on my truck?
Let me show you.
What is going on with you and my son?
He wanted to help somebody. Wanted to get somebody back on their feet, so...
Looks to me like you got yourself a little problem.
I can lick it. You ever been on the street? Well... You can't know, not until you're looking at a dumpster. But when you climb into that thing for the first time, and you pull those newspapers over you, that's when you know that you've messed your life up. Somebody comes along like your son and gives me a leg up. I'll take it. Even from a kid, I'll take it.
I'm not gonna hurt you!
Please, go away! Trust me!
Have a cup of coffee with me?
What?
Do me a favor. Save my life.
Hi, I'm Chris Chandler, and I'm joined today by a very unusual seventh grader, Trevor McKinney. Trevor, you must be pretty proud of yourself.
I guess, I mean, I got an A in social studies, but that was just for the effort. I mean, stuff I did, it didn't really work out.
I don't know, I tried real hard, but nothing really happened.
But something did happen. Lives were changed because someone thought of others before themselves. And just because this young man didn't see changes happen, they did. A homeless man saved a woman from killing herself. How we treat others matters. Let your love be genuine. Lead with kindness. Ease up on the snarkiness with those with whom we disagree. Fill the world with love. With a vision in our minds of how the world could be, and the fullness in our hearts from the suffering we see, when we make all that we are and have part of God's destiny, we can fill God's world with love. Let us hesitate no longer in our doubt and our dismay. There's a power at work within us that has promised a new day. And the time is surely now, as Christ's followers we pray. God will fill our world with love. Amen.
Yeah.
The beauty of coming around a table is that it's for everyone. It is for those whom we agree and those whom we disagree. Consider the disciples. The 12 disciples were as different as you could imagine. Simon the Zealot was a patriot kind of redneck who hated the Roman government. And sitting across the table with him was Matthew the tax collector, who was a collaborator with Rome. You know, that'd be like putting Sean Hannity and Rachel Maddow at the table together for 3 years. They'd about slit each other's throats. But Jesus united them. Peter and Thomas were very different. Peter was impulsive, quick to believe, fickle. Thomas was a thinker who responded and was deeply committed. And all these personalities must have unnerved each other at times. But they were united by a cause much bigger than their own egos. Christ Jesus. When Jesus invited them around a table on that night before he was betrayed, he not only instituted the Lord's Supper, a remembrance of bread, his body broken, a cup, his blood poured out for the forgiveness of their sins, but he showed them what it meant also to be a servant by washing their feet. And then he said these words recorded in the Gospel of John, "I give to you a new commandment, that you love one another. Just as I have loved you, you should also love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another." As we partake in these elements today, Jesus reminds us that we are called to love all the people, even those who think differently than we do. Let us partake of the bread and the cup.
We at Disciples First Christian Church would like to remind you that our motto is love all the people. We also have a bit of a motto in the name of our church that you'll see, Disciples First Christian Church. We've been First Christian Church for a long time. Now we want to give some emphasis to the fact that we seek to be disciples first. To love all the people and to be disciples first, in this special time, let's not forget that we have much to accomplish in the name of Jesus Christ.
Now we invite you to sing with us our song of invitation, and may it be a prayer to God.
Side by side, and we'll guard each one's dignity and say, Will they know we are Christians by our love? That is the question. We are disciples first. We are followers in the way of Jesus. We are called to love all the people, even the ones that we don't agree with. As we come to the end of our service today, I want you to know that we have given a lot of bicycles away this week. Ministry is still happening, even in the midst of a pandemic. You can still give to the church financially, and we would encourage you to do that. You can send a check in to the church's P.O. box, or you can also go to the church's website and give through Givelify. We are called to love. Let us depart from one another as we this worship service, and let us love all the people. Amen.